And lately, of course, one of the most popular questions I've been getting is, should I get the COVID vaccine if I'm pregnant? We can do a 10-episode miniseries just on the COVID vaccine alone, but for this video today, I want to just speak to the decision for those of you that are pregnant. We'll break everything down by talking about what we know about the vaccine so far, what we know about the immune systems of pregnant people, what are some of the reasons to get the vaccine for pregnant people, what are some of the unknowns and the risks that we're still learning about, and then a couple words about the decision-making process. I'm here to present the evidence to you to empower you to make the best decision for yourself and your family. So let's dive right in. Hi there, welcome to Ask Dr. Amy. I'm a board-certified pediatrician and the founder of Kinder Digital Pediatric Clinic. On this channel, I answer questions from parents just like you, and we talk about anything and everything that have to do with pediatric and family health. So that's medicine, nutrition, lifestyle, mental health, parenting tips, all the dimensions of health that are connected. So like anything else that we say about COVID in this fast-changing pandemic, everything is up to date as of the time we talk about it. So this is up to date to the best of my knowledge as of today. So the first two vaccines for COVID that were approved in this country, the Pfizer one and the Moderna one, are called mRNA vaccines. You might have seen this in the headlines lately so far. It's been talked about quite a lot because it's a relatively new technology to make the vaccine. So if we think of our immune system, like say cops, and they're being trained to catch certain robbers before they harm the city. So in traditional vaccines, we can compare it to presenting some robbers to the cops. Now the robbers are already in handcuffs, so they can't do too much damage. The cops get to look at them, learn what they look like. So the next time, if they see them, they can chase them down quickly and recognize them quickly and catch them before they really harm anybody. Now the difference between that and an mRNA vaccine is instead of presenting the robbers, we're presenting, let's say, portraits and pictures of the robbers. The body then takes a look at the pictures and they produce robbers who then get presented to the cops and the same process follows. So the difference here is really what's being presented to the body. And with mRNA, there's an extra step of taking the blueprint, taking the portrait, and then producing the robbers for the cops to recognize. I don't want to get too much and caught up in the nitty-gritty details here because I care about functionally, how does this matter? For us, how does that help us make the decision? Because functionally, the risk for an mRNA vaccine then is being compared to a traditional dead vaccine, like the flu shot, like Tdap. And we'll talk a little bit more about live versus dead vaccines later. But basically, understanding this mechanism is really to say that we are treating the risk factors for the mRNA vaccine theoretically the same as other dead vaccines. What we also know is that between the two vaccines given in the trials for both Pfizer and Moderna, there are individuals who got pregnant. Now, because of the way the study was set up, those individuals were then excluded from the trials going forward, so their data was not counted because the study wasn't set up to study as the safe in pregnant people. And as far as we know, no adverse reactions we know of have happened to those pregnancies and those individuals. But of course, we also have to keep in mind, this is spring of 2021, so there hasn't been enough time for a full pregnancy to come to term, and much less time for that pregnancy to result in a baby for us to study the baby and the development, just because of where we are in time in terms of learning about the full extent of this vaccine. Now, I also want to talk a little bit about the immune systems of pregnant people. There are two things to keep in mind. One, the immune systems of pregnant people are thought of as being a little bit weaker than a non-pregnant person. And two, we know that immune activation during pregnancy can be risky. So we'll talk about one at a time. For number one, because the immune system is thought to be a little bit weaker, pregnant people are more likely to catch certain illnesses, say like the flu. And if they do catch it, they're thought of as more likely or at higher risk to have a more serious course. So for COVID, for example, we know that compared to non-pregnant individuals, they have a higher chance of having serious disease, such as needing to be hospitalized, needing to be on a ventilator. It's more likely that they will deliver a little bit early, although we're not seeing very early or miscarriages thought to be associated with that. Now, secondly, we know that immune activation, especially large and dramatic immune system activation during pregnancy, can be risky. Take something like CMV, which are very common viruses that you and I have likely already had. Most people in the population have had. But very rarely, some individuals don't get this until they're pregnant. And if this happens where they have an initial infection, which causes a larger immune reaction of these common viruses during pregnancy, going back to our example earlier, it's like having a big team of cops actively pounding down and searching for robbers in the city, which causes a lot of upheaval. It can lead to some devastating harm to the fetus and to the eventual baby who are born. They can be born deaf and blind. This also goes for other viruses like the herpes virus and other infections that if a pregnant person is getting them for the first time during pregnancy, the results are much worse. And in fact, we're told that pregnant people also shouldn't let their body temperature rise above a certain point. All of which to say, since the fetus is so closely dependent on the pregnant person, immune activation during pregnancy is risky. Now, our immune systems are activated by either having a disease or by getting a vaccine. So some vaccines are thought of as too high risk, so we don't actually give it during pregnancy. In fact, here is the list of recommendations. Here we have the safe recommended dead vaccines that we routinely give during pregnancy. The live ones are contraindicated, meaning we don't give during pregnancy. And a live vaccine, if we want to fit it into our metaphor before, would be like introducing robbers who are not cuffed and they're able to run. And the cops will eventually catch them, but it's just a little bit more active of a process. And there's a very low, but still possible risk that one of them gets away and we actually get the disease that we're vaccinating for. And then there are some in the middle. We either haven't studied them enough or they're usually not needed. And we say, we're not really sure here. So make individual decisions based on the risks and benefits. So where does the COVID vaccine fit in? That's the question. It is being thought of as a dead vaccine in the low-risk column because it does not introduce a live virus, but we haven't studied it enough, and in fact, the FDA hasn't officially approved it. It's being used under an emergency act. So because of the unknown nature of it, right now, it really fits in the middle column. So given that overview of what we know about the vaccine, about pregnancy, what are some of the situations where a pregnant person might benefit the most from the vaccine? Because remember, if they get vaccinated, then there's a much, much lower chance of getting the disease, which, like we said, during pregnancy can have a more severe course. So those with a high-risk pregnancy to begin with, or those who have other comorbidities or conditions that make them more likely to have a severe COVID course, those who are at higher risk of being exposed to COVID, especially healthcare workers, and of course, those who live in areas where the transmission of COVID is very rampant. But again, I really, really encourage you to talk to your healthcare provider, whoever's caring for you during this pregnancy, to talk about this risk scenario. Because again, you and your family are unique, and I hope that whoever's taking care of you can go over your individual risk factors with you. And of course, all the elements in your medical history that's relevant here. Because what we know today is that there is no theoretical risk and there has been no observed bad outcome in this very, very early course of us learning about the vaccine. But theory has to be studied, and that's the premise of evidence-based medicine. And we simply haven't had enough time, but the short-term evidence that we see are very encouraging so far. So those are some of the arguments for getting the vaccine. But there also are some unknowns and risks that we're still having to study. Like I said, theory has to be proved by evidence. And the unknown is simply that we need enough time for the pregnancies to come to term, for the babies to be born, and we have to keep studying the babies, even years down the road, and really study their development as they go to school, as they acquire new skills, before we conclusively say anything, either about contracting COVID during pregnancy and about getting the vaccine during pregnancy. This is the way that all other vaccines have been studied before they're officially recommended for pregnant people. So it's a tricky balance right now. We're in the pandemic and the vaccine is potentially life-saving for a lot of people. But I also want you to feel like it's okay to ask questions. It's okay to look at the situation and say, we don't have all the evidence. I have more questions about this. Again, as a pediatrician, the test and the evidence for all this doesn't just end by the end of the pregnancy. That is a great milestone, a marker when a healthy baby is born. We do need to keep studying the baby. I'm relieved and very excited to learn that both women who've had the vaccine and also women who've had COVID during pregnancy. So far, they have given birth to perfectly healthy, normal babies, which is awesome. But I also want to make space for your questions if you have any doubts. And I would empower you to take the information as we know it today and sit with it, talk to your doctor, and really come up with a decision and a timeline that works for you. This is not black and white, and I would be wary of any person or source of information that makes you feel like this is a simple black and white choice, that you're not supposed to have questions. And now going forward, the trials on pregnant people for the COVID vaccine have finally begun. And in March of this year, for the first time, we were able to conclusively see that the antibodies from the vaccine, the COVID vaccine, are found in the umbilical cord blood and in breast milk, meaning it's a very good sign that antibodies are being passed on to the baby. Now, we still need more time to see what does this mean? Does it actually change the baby's risk factors? But again, these are all encouraging data points that we're seeing. It's especially hard when both sides do contain the unknowns. Your risk for getting COVID, the potential course of COVID you could have, versus the long-term effects of the vaccine. So I encourage you to objectively evaluate your risk factors, your situation, and talk to your doctor about what's right for you. Now, if you're somebody who has had to make this decision or you're in the middle of making it now, please leave us a comment below and let us know what you decided or how you're thinking of it. I think it's helpful in our community to keep the conversations open and we can learn from each other's experience. We'll let the evidence speak for itself over time.